Hello, I'm Eric Snodgrass, and thank you for watching today's Midday Weather Outlook for the Southern Region, brought to you by Nutrien Ag Solutions. Let's start by taking a look at the last 14 days in terms of the departure of normal from precipitation. And what we can see here is that a big section of the eastern half of our southern region has at times been exceptionally wet, some locations in here well in excess of 5 additional inches of precipitation. Now, it's not as though the storms have been everywhere and given everybody a soaking rain here, but we did at least add this over the last few days here to the map that you just saw. And this morning we're still watching lingering showers from the frontal boundary that passed, really dumping a lot of rain in through this region, kind of finally passing off toward the Gulf Coast and the East Coast today. So overall, we just need to take a look at where we stand currently with our precipitation. So we're going to go straight to the drought monitor that was released on Thursday. And we can see here that slowly with time, we've kind of eroded away quite a bit of the drought, especially inside the two lines that I just drew here. But still, parts of central Texas and parts of the southeast have been very, very dry. Now, when we look at how much things have changed, the cool thing about the drought monitor is they actually put up a class change map, and I've showed it to you quite a few times here, but we're looking now at the most recent one-month class change, and we can actually see in some parts of the southeast, also parts of eastern Texas, getting up into the mid-south and the kind of the Ohio River Valley area, some locations here up to a 3-class improvement in the last month. So that's been a major pattern reversal from summer, where we were so dry here simply due to that large protective ridge that was in place for so long. So where are we going in the near term with precipitation? Well, this was last evening's precip. We can see that it's been moving out in the early morning hours this morning, and we'll see that by midday today, that rain should be all the way off the coast and much higher pressure should be coming in. So this map, I stopped it here right about 3 o'clock East Coast time. Now we'll notice through south central Texas later on this afternoon and early this evening some widespread scattered showers, but overall after that, high pressure dominates and much cooler weather is in place through much of our weekend. And it'll be a very dry weekend through much of the southern region. So if we just take a look at this now from that point moving forward, we're going to start off with our European model. We'll get some precipitation totals in just a few seconds. So let's pause it right here. This is Saturday evening, and we want to be watching for when the next round of precipitation comes through. Keep a close eye on the north central plains, okay? So this is now Sunday morning, around 7 o'clock in the morning for East Coast time. We can see that right here by Sunday evening, we're watching our next big dome of high atmospheric pressure come out here of the Rocky Mountains and really slide along parts of Montana, Wyoming, coming down through the central plains. At that same time, we will see a very tight pressure gradient. We talked about this in yesterday's video too, setting up right in through this area. So Texas, Oklahoma, Arkansas, you're going to be seeing some incredibly strong winds, even getting up into the northern part of our southern region, so Kansas and Missouri. And what's going on here is we got the competition again between two high pressure cells. So one over here spinning like this, another one here spinning like this. They both spin clockwise, and we're trying to develop a weak little low in this area. So you'll see here that that overpowering front pushes through. So our next chance at precipitation getting into the southern region will be Monday midday through Monday evening. You can see it coming through here on that big front that's sweeping through. Now, as that pushes hard to the south, this is a cold rain that's coming through here Monday evening, and it's going to blast through pretty quickly. See that? Now, the tricky part of this forecast will be, given that this is midnight on Monday night to Tuesday, are we going to be able to get the changeover to snow here kind of in the hilly mountainous area that's parts of central Tennessee and Kentucky? And that's a notoriously very difficult place to forecast snow because of the elevation. Right now, the ECMWF, again, lower resolution model, but still picking up on the changeover in that area. So we need to watch very carefully in through here to see how this changes over. But as this passes through, this is now Tuesday morning, Tuesday afternoon, Tuesday evening. We've blasted that next front through, and higher atmospheric pressure and some of the coldest air that we've seen in a very long time is now established here by early Wednesday morning. And in a few moments, I'm going to show you how far to the south the current projections are for getting that that freezing temperature line, because you can see that, see this little line right in through here? That's the freezing line from the European model. You can see it gets all the way down to the Gulf Coast. So we're talking parts of the Panhandle of Florida, all of the Carolinas, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, New Orleans, excuse me, Louisiana, but I was thinking New Orleans. New Orleans might be the only spot that stays above freezing down here. So this is some very cold air that comes in. Now, something we're just going to watch, I've been advertising it throughout this entire week, but I want to just keep an eye on it. After that big high pressure cell moves through and the trough is deep, We are seeing that by next Thursday. Now, this is a week out, you know, or so in the forecast, that something's kind of brewing here in the Gulf. Now, this is not a tropical system, but this is a Gulf low. It's what we call them. They kind of form on the tail end of these big cold fronts, and they tend to ride what's called the baroclinic zone. This is where we have strong moisture and temperature contrast along the coast. You can see it sweeps through Florida and tries to race up here along the East Coast. Now, please understand, we're looking at one operational model. We are way out here in the forecast. This is Saturday the 16th, but I want to watch it all weekend to see if the models continue to advertise the development of this, because these types of storm systems can be exceptionally powerful. So we need to watch out for this one very, very closely. So just looking at this, this is the next 5 days after the rainfall gets through. So really what we're watching is that next big high pressure cell slide down, and on the leading edge of the front that will be advancing like this, that's where we're going to be getting these lighter precipitation amounts overall. The heaviest rainfall, if I back those colors off there, looks to be in parts of Arkansas, Louisiana, eastern Texas, and western and southern Mississippi here, where we might be picking up another an inch of rain with that next big front that's coming through early next week. But then you can see the high pressure cell comes in and clears this out. What we're watching after that, so this is the following 5 days, is the potential for something to sneak up the coast like this. So I got to watch it carefully. It's not set in stone, but let's keep an eye out on that for deep into next week. Overall, when I put it together and just look at week two GFS ensemble, European ensemble, can you see how both models right now are trying to do something in that area? So we see wetter than average conditions there, while the much drier air sliding in behind this on the overall pattern change, bringing in much higher atmospheric pressure. So that's certainly the mainstay of the story through the next couple of weeks. Okay, so let's talk about those temperatures, because already early this morning we have freeze watches and hard freeze warnings out for a big section of our southern region here. We've already seen the freeze extent get this far once this year, so this will kind of be the second time we're getting these kind of cold temperatures in this area. And before we get into that, the bigger question is, how deep is that trough that comes in here? So this is next Tuesday when this really cold air comes in. So round one is here. That's a much bigger push right there next Tuesday morning into Wednesday morning. And now watch, before I get into the details on those temperatures, let's just see if things change once we get out past mid-month. So this is now the 15th, getting into the 16th, 17th, and 18th. Now, what's got me interested at this point is we are seeing this high over low pattern establish itself here, basically between the Pacific Northwest and the Baja. And this would indicate that this feature right here may help with the development of getting something out of the Gulf of Mexico and then maybe racing up the coast at some point. It's the combination of this, and this that has me thinking that maybe something sneaks along here at that time period. But I want to see, when does this pattern change? And we do notice that by the time we get into the third week of the month, we really start to crank up the Pacific jet right in through here, and that may be enough to break through the block and finally start to change our pattern overall once we get into the third week of the month. So now let's see what that means in terms of temperatures. I'm a little scared to show you this, but let's take a look at what our daily high temperatures look like compared to average from the National Digital Forecast Database before I show you those lows. So as I click play on this, this is Friday, departure from normal. Okay, now watch this. This is Saturday. Now Saturday is not gonna, you know, you see, whoa, what the heck is going on here? Well, remember, this is before the big atmosphere or high atmospheric pressure area comes sliding through. Now watch what happens after it comes blasting through. See this much above average temperatures here while the southeast is still 10 to 15 cooler. Here it goes. This is now Sunday departure from normal, so pleasant day here across our southern region, but you see what's coming. Monday, that's departure from normal. Tuesday, 30 degree swing or differences in normal here, and we get through next Wednesday and Thursday. That is an incredible change in temperature. You look at this map and go, that wouldn't look too bad. It's still 10 to 15 degrees colder than average. So we have a very brutal Arctic air mass that will be sliding through early next week. Now let's watch these overnight low temperatures. It's gonna play fast, but I'll pause you, whoops, and take you back and show you the days I'm worried about. So this is minimum temperatures this morning on Friday. This is Saturday. Now Sunday things start to reload. Cold air advances Monday, Tuesday, and then here will probably be the coldest morning we'll experience. This is next Wednesday morning on the 13th. You see where that freezing line is, all the way down to southern Texas, hits almost all of Louisiana, maybe saving New Orleans here, but almost all of Mississippi, except for probably the coast. Look at how far south that is. And in this time of year, getting this cold a temperature down here is quite rare. Just to let you know, the temperatures that we're seeing up here, this would be a cold day in February for the Midwest. So this is some exceptionally cold air that we've stored up here in central Canada that's now slid down through the Midwest and hammered our southern region. So I think you all are pretty well aware that our 5-day map and our 6 to 10 day map are going to look just like this. We've been talking about this for a while, but take a look at the 11 to 15 day. Starting to see some moderation overall, and that's possibly due to that breakdown in the flow of the jet stream over the Pacific. Now, to reinforce this, I want to show you a couple of things. We have been, in a pattern, if you look right here, such that we've had this dominant kind of lower atmospheric pressure over Siberia. So normally we want to pay attention to the Siberian high, if it's above average or below average. We can see the red showing up here? This is where over the next 15 days or so, we're seeing the operational GFS model advertising a breakdown in the low pressure that's been over Siberia. If we build in a big high there, a lot of the cold air is going to shift to that part of the Northern Hemisphere. Meanwhile, over the Aleutian Islands, where we've had a lot of ridging, we can see that now things are going back over toward, well, more neutral conditions. So this is signaling an overall pattern change in the Pacific Ocean. There's another way to look at it as well. Now this is going back in time like this, and this is cutting across lines of latitude. So this is the international dateline. Now do you see this feature here? We're looking at upper level motion in the atmosphere, and we can see that with time, we're going to be breaking away from a pattern where for a while here we had been occupied by these colors here as we get over to the west coast, and now we're starting to see this. So this indicates a pattern change that is happening, but maybe not getting here until the third week of the month. And I can show you that now by looking at the European model. Now I don't... Using the European model look out this far, it's great. It's the best we honestly have. We have to look at the trend and things, and we have to look at the pattern. And overall, I guess what I'm seeing here is what I'm not seeing. And that is one of these highly amplified patterns that keep things just highly polarized in terms of temperatures. So we see a relaxation in what we've seen over the last couple of days. While the third week of the month still keeps the northwest on the drier side, we are possibly seeing an increase in the strength of the subtropical jet stream. And you can see that it's maybe advertising. Now, this is the 21st to the 20th of the month, maybe a wetter pattern down here. So I'm just telling you that we have things changing in the Pacific Ocean that could be leading up to something like this. And then by week four, this is just to see this, so this would now be, you know, really getting into the first week of December, we almost go back over into what appears to be from the European model, cooler than average weather here. Now I want to let you know something. The European model weekly forecast was disastrously bad at predicting the cold air that we've most recently had. So I'm trying to blend together some of the changes I'm seeing out in the Pacific Ocean and also in Siberia with this particular model run, which just came out last night. So I think it's something that all of us for the week three, week four, just need to keep an eye on. It'll be very important, I know, next week to watch my videos to see how I maybe change that opinion over the weekend, okay? Finally, just want to point one last thing out to you. Globally, when we take a look at a few things here, just to keep you updated with what's going on in South America, still seeing this wetter pattern, you know, in through this quarter with drier in the east, but it's also been very dry in parts of Australia as of late. And if you look here, this was just early this morning, and we can see the sunrise here, and you can see the fires here on the eastern side of Australia. And if I kind of zoom in and show you them, take a look at the extensive smoke plumes from these fires. So impressive to see this. So very, very dry in this part of the world as well. Just want to give you that update as you slide into your weekend. I hope you have a great weekend. We'll talk to you again next week. Thank you.